Assalamu alaikum. Welcome again. In the coming few videos, we'll be covering some important topics in neuroanatomy. And we will start with the basal ganglia. Okay, so the basal ganglia simply means basal, base of the brain, and ganglia, collection of cell bodies. So the basal ganglia lies in the cerebrum, and it consists of four subcortical nuclei. The major function of these nuclei is to control the primary voluntary movement of the body. However, the basal ganglia is not considered part of the pyramidal system. Instead, it's a part of the extrapyramidal system. Now, we will go in more depth and discuss the function of the basal ganglia and its nuclei. The four major nuclei of the basal ganglia are, first, striatum, which consists of the caudate, putamen, and nucleus accumbens. The striatum is known to be the major input nucleus, so please keep it in your mind. Then we have globus pallidus, and it consists of two parts, globus pallidus interna and globus pallidus externa. Third, we have substantia nigra, and again it's divided into two parts, substantia nigra pars compacta and substantia nigra pars reticulata. Fourth and last component is the subthalamic nucleus. Also, it's worth mentioning that both globus pallidus and substantia nigra pars reticulata are considered to be the major output nuclei of the basal ganglia. And these four major nuclei are connected by neurons. These neurons release one of the neurotransmitters. The neurotransmitters are GABA, which is inhibitory, glutamate, excitatory, acetylcholine, found in the striatum, and dopamine, and it's projected from substantia nigra pars compacta. Now that we have a general view about the nuclei and their location in the brain, we will see how they control our movements. The basal ganglia lies very closely to the thalamus, which is important for transmitting the signals from and to the cortex or cerebral cortex, both motor and sensory information. The striatum, which is the major input nucleus if you still remember, projects to the globus pallidus via two major pathways, the direct and the indirect pathway. Keep it in your mind that these pathways or two pathways have the opposite functions. So at rest, the thalamus is tonically inhibited by the action of globus pallidus interna with the help of substantia nigra pars reticulata. Again, please keep this in your mind while we go through both pathways. So, if you want to move, you will be activating the direct pathway. So, let's start with it. Signals from cerebral cortex will activate the striatum, which will then inhibit globus pallidus interna, and by that, we're releasing the thalamus from globus pallidus interna inhibition, so you can freely move. On the other hand, the indirect pathway, which is activated to prevent any unwanted movements, happens as follows. Again, starting from higher centers in the cerebral cortex, signals come to the striatum, activating it. Then, the striatum will inhibit globus pallidus externa now. Globus pallidus externa, when active, inhibits subthalamic nucleus. So, by inhibiting it, or globus pallidus externa, we are leaving the subthalamic nucleus active. Subthalamic nucleus activates globus pallidus interna. And as we said at the beginning, globus pallidus interna usually inhibits the thalamus. So, no movement can occur. So, in summary, the direct pathway is for our primary movements, while all the other unwanted movements are usually inhibited by the indirect pathway. So, how are the direct and indirect pathways regulated? In the striatum, we have both dopamine 1 and dopamine 2 receptors. From substantia nigra pars compacta, dopaminergic neurons can activate or inhibit the striatum, regulating direct and indirect pathways, respectively. So if the substantia nigra pars compacta dopamine activates D1 receptor, this will activate the striatum, leading to the direct pathway. On the other hand, if the substantia nigra pars compacta dopamine activates D2 receptors, This will inhibit striatum, inactivating the indirect pathway, so less inhibition on the thalamus, leading to more movement. After we understood the major mechanisms of the basal ganglia, we will look into the major abnormalities that can happen, and we will discuss three conditions: Parkinson's disease, which is hypokinetic, Huntington chorea, which is hyperkinetic, and lastly Hemiballismus, which is hyperkinetic again. So first, Parkinson's disease. The substantia nigra pars compacta is damaged, depleting the dopaminergic neurons, so no dopamine will reach the striatum, and thus they cannot activate D1 nor D2 receptors. So the indirect and direct pathways are both affected. So if no dopamine can reach D1 receptor, no activation of striatum, and then no inhibition of globus pallidus interna, and consequently we will have continuous inhibition of the thalamus, so it will be very difficult for the person to move. On the other hand, if no dopamine can reach D2 receptors, we will have no inhibition of the subthalamus, and then this will keep globus pallidus interna active, and the globus pallidus interna will inhibit the thalamus, leading to tremors and inability to move. On the other hand, Huntington's disease, which is an autosomal dominant disease, there will be an accumulation of a mutant Huntington protein. This protein will accumulate inside the neurons and causes their degeneration. Usually, the striatum neurons are responsible for the inhibition of globus pallidus externa are degenerated, thus affecting the indirect pathway. Affected striatum will lead to decreased inhibition of globus pallidus externa. The globus pallidus externa is free to inhibit the subthalamic nucleus, so we will have less excitation of globus pallidus interna and less inhibition of the thalamus, consequently resulting in involuntary movements at rest. Lastly, another hyperkinetic disorder of the basal ganglia is known as hemiballismus. Basically, in this case, there's a lesion in the subthalamic nucleus, so it does not excite globus pallidus interna, so you'll have less inhibition on the thalamus, and consequently, involuntary movements of one half of the body. In summary, any lesion in the basal ganglia might result in one of the three consequences. First, tremor or other involuntary movement. Second, changes in muscle tone or posture. Third and last, poverty of movement without paralysis. These symptoms are collectively known or called as extrapyramidal symptoms or extrapyramidal syndromes. All in all, the basal ganglia is important in voluntary movements and making our postural adjustments. It receives cortical input and provides feedback to the cortex to modulate our movements. And this is it for the basal ganglia. Hope you enjoyed. Please give us your feedback so we improve in the next videos. And as always, please do not forget to like and subscribe to get our new videos and explanations. Ciao!